Dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. In this module, we will study about life cycle assessments. As of now, you all know that our earth has very limited resources and they are known as the non-renewable resources. Keeping up with the developmental activities in various sectors, the non-renewable resources are being degraded and over-exploited, which has given rise to an environmental crisis. The effects of the environmental crisis may be very slow and sometimes unnoticeable and sometimes highly significant and observable. They affect humanity and the environment in various ways. So, in order to maintain a balance and to keep up the well-being of the current generation as well as the future generation, we need to formulate the proper environmental management plans and devise some methodologies. This recent time has seen the scientific community, the policy makers as well as the people to come forward together in order to formulate proper plans and environmental friendly procedures. In this regard, life cycle assessment has been developed as a very recent and effective tool in environmental management practices. In this module, we will be studying about the brief history of LCA, the types of LCA and the technical framework to carry out the LCA procedure, and at the end, the advantages and disadvantages of LCA. So, let's get started. Coming to the introduction part, which gives a general idea about the life cycle assessment procedures, the LCA procedures. There has been growing global concern over the increasing trend in the over-exploitation of non-renewable resources, as I said earlier, and this has resulted in the industries and business companies to assess their activities and product performance, how they affect the environment. A number of businesses have responded to this awareness by providing greener products and using greener processes by use of pollution prevention strategies and environmental management systems. One such tool is called the life cycle assessment, or in short LCA. The LCA concept considers the entire life cycle of a product, including its manufacture, the raw material acquisition and the use and maintenance phase, as well as its final disposal. Life cycle approaches can contribute information towards the development of practical action plans and programs to address unsustainable consumption, degradation, and production patterns. These diagrams depict the entire process of life cycle assessment in terms of the phases and the aspects taken into consideration. Coming to brief history of LCA, it was first emerged in the early 70s, particularly in some countries like Sweden, the UK, Switzerland and the USA. In the 1970s, the US EPA redefined the methodology known as Resource and Environmental Profile Analysis, in short RIPA, for evaluation of environmental impacts of products. The method had its roots in energy and waste management, and the products upon which analysis was executed in the initial period were beverage containers and diapers. The list later added some other products as well as services, which include paints, refrigerators, window edgings, etc. But there were some problems, like, but for being performed using different methods and without a common theoretical framework, the consequences were largely negative. Hence, under the efforts of the Society of Environmental Toxicology and Chemistry, the CTAC, measures were undertaken to harmonize the methodology. They have produced their code of practice in the year 1992. After that, the International Organization for Standardization, ISO, on behalf of the Standardization of Environmental Management, has prepared an LCA standard known as the ISO 14040 series, and also a standard for LCA based environmental product declarations. The United Nations Environment Programme, UNEP, also has been actively involved in stimulating the application of life cycle approaches in practice. The list of products subjected to LCA since past years has grown rapidly. So, what is life cycle assessment? Life cycle of a product refers to the complete time span of its existence, starting from its making, which may include the raw material extraction for manufacture, to the end of its use phase, that is till its destruction or recycling or remodification. In short, life cycle assessment consists of the technical system of processes and transport routes used, raw material extraction, production, use and after use. Hence, this is also known as cradle to grave assessment. It has given rise to the notion of life cycle thinking. This notion states that the entire production life from cradle to grave should be assessed in order to identify the environmental impacts of a product or service. As per ISO 14040 series, LCA is a technique for assessing the environmental aspects and potential impacts associated with a product by compiling an inventory of relevant inputs and outputs of a system, evaluating the potential environmental impacts associated with those inputs and outputs, and interpreting the results of the inventory and impact phases in relation to the objectives of the study. The impacts of material and energy flows along with the production chain are estimated in this process. Ideally, they identify the main impacts and help in finding solutions to minimize the environmental effects. Now, coming to types of LCA. There are various types of LCA, which are cradle to gate, cradle to cradle, which is also known as closed loop production, gate to gate type, well to wheel, ecological input output life cycle assessment, and ecologically based LCA. We will go through them one by one. First, the cradle to grave type. In cradle to grave type, we do the complete LCA analysis, starting from raw material extraction, which can be called as cradle, to use phase and disposal phase, the disposal phase being the grave. All inputs and outputs are reflected for all the stages of the life cycle in this type of LCA. Then moving to cradle to gate type. In cradle to gate type of assessment, the partial life cycle of a product from its material extraction to the factory gate, that is after the production stage where it moves for consumers. The use phase and disposal phase of the product are omitted in cradle to grave type of LCA. Then moving to cradle or closed loop production, in which the end of life disposal step of the product is a recycling process. This method minimizes the environmental impact of products by employing suitable, sustainable production, operation and disposal practices. Moving to gate-to-gate kind of LCA, gate-to-gate is a partial LCA that considers only one value-added process in the entire production chain. Gate-to-gate modules may also later be associated with the appropriate production chain to form a complete cradle-to-gate evaluation. The next one is well-to-wheel type of LCA. This type of LCA is generally done for transport fuels and automobiles. This analysis is often fragmented down into stages, which are known as well-to-station or well-to-tank, station-to-wheel, tank-to-wheel or plug-to-wheel. The first stage, known as the upstream stage, involves feedstock and fuel production, processing and fuel delivery or energy transmission. The next stage deals with dealing with vehicle operation and is known as downstream stage. This is frequently used to evaluate total energy consumption or the energy conversion efficiency and emission influence of marine vessels, aircrafts and automobiles. The economic input output LCA involves the use of sector-wise data on the quantum of environmental impact that can be imposed on the environment by each sector of the economy. Such analysis can account many connected business sectors. However, this type of LCA depends on sector level averages, which may or may not be characteristic of the specific subsection of the sector related to a particular product, and hence not suitable for evaluating the environmental impacts of the products. Also, the translation of economic quantities into environmental impacts is not validated. The last type of LCA is the ecologically based LCA, which considers a much wider range of ecological impacts, and hence it is very suitable for environmental planning. It is planned to provide a guide to the judicious management of human activities by understanding the direct and indirect impacts on surrounding ecosystems and resources. It was developed by Ohio State University Center for Resilience. The technical framework or procedure involves four steps. They are goal and scope, inventory, impact assessment, and interpretation. For successful LC analysis, the ISO has laid down certain standards. They are ISO 14040, which is about the principles and framework, ISO 14041, which is about the inventory analysis, then ISO 14042, which is about the impact assessment, and finally the ISO 14043, which deals with the interpretation part. This diagram explains schematically the interrelation between different steps in the LCA process and some of the direct applications, which are product development and improvement, strategic planning, public policy making, marketing, and others. Now we will go through every component gradually, the first one being goal and scope. In order to ensure the constancy of the LCA study, the goal should state the aim of carrying out the study and to whom it will be communicated. The scope describes the most important methodological choices, assumptions made, and the limitations of the study. This phase requires to understand certain terms which include functional unit, system boundaries, system assumptions, system limitations, certain principles of allocation and quality of data. The functional unit can be defined as the scale for comparison of two or more products, including improvement, to one product. All data collected in the inventory phase is related to this functional unit. Then comes the system boundaries, which define the processes or operations and the inputs and outputs of energy flow and material flow to be taken into account to carry out the LCA study. The system assumptions describe handling of elementary features in calculations. Then the system limitations are made towards nature, time frame, geographical area, capital goods, and other product life cycles which interact with the process. Allocation principles consider the output of several products from the same production system. The quality of the data used in the inventory is naturally reflected in the quality of the ultimate LCA result. So it is essential that the data quality is described and assessed in a methodical way which allows others to comprehend and control the actual data quality. Initial data quality requirements aimed at define certain parameters such as time-related coverage, which includes the desired age and the minimum length of time for the study, also the technological coverage and geographical coverages. The technological coverage relates to the nature of the technology involved, which might be the weighted average of the actual process mix, best available technology, or worst operating unit. Under geographical coverage, the geographic area from which data for unit operation should be collected to satisfy the goal of the study without biasness is decided. This might be local or regional or national, continental or global. The next component or next step is life cycle inventory analysis. Inventory analysis is characterized by the assimilation of the data and the modeling of energy flows for the product or the process or the service under the study. The data collected and used here includes all the environmental and technical quantities of all significant unit processes within the system boundaries. The uses of energy, water, and materials and their associated releases to the environment are also identified and quantified in this step. The next step is the life cycle impact assessment. In this stage, the loadings which have been identified in the inventory analysis are characterized and assessed based on their effects to the environment. This phase consists of three consecutive elements, which are classification, characterization, and valuation. In classification, various impact categories based on the environmental impacts are decided, identified, and the loadings are assigned to each impact category they contribute to. Appropriate impact category selection is highly crucial in this stage. Some examples of impact categories are resource depletion, which includes the depletion of biotic and abiotic resources, pollution, which covers global warming, ozone depletion, acidification, eutrophication, human toxicity, ecotoxicity, etc., and also the degradation of land ecosystems and landscape. The next element being characterization. assesses the contribution of all input-output data from the inventory to the respective category to finally obtain an impact profile for the product assessed. This is assisted by using models which combine the input-output data from the inventory and the so-called indicators that express the environmental effects or harms. In general, the indicators allow for an aggregation of all emission-based contributions within each category in terms of a unit. If appropriate, the characterization factors are also used to enumerate the contribution of each single emission to that category. An appropriate set of impact factors is applied for impact aggregation. There are two primary categories of life cycle impact factors, which are midpoint and endpoint. The midpoint assessment methods are more scientifically variable as they use a standard of impact category for a given inventory value, such as methane to carbon dioxide equivalents. On the other hand, the endpoint impacts strive to give an actual environmental or economic output to the emissions. Though the endpoint assessment methods are well formulated, they usually apply some assumptions that deviate from assessable outcomes, such as an increase in mean global temperature due to methane emissions. During this step, it is possible to precisely categorize or spatially normalize or weigh the impacts to determine a total LCA score. Use of the standardization techniques depend on the goal of the particular study and may also incorporate additional uncertainty into the analysis as per requirement. This comes under the last element of impact assessment, which is valuation. Valuation attempts to compare and rank the differing impact categories to simplify them down to a common base. The last and final step of LCA analysis is interpretation. In interpretation phase, the results of previous LCA studies are compared with the goal of the study, which is set in the beginning. Validation is an important concern here. Generally, it is done in two ways, either by the LCA practitioners or by independent way by external review like a peer review. Also, there is the improvement assessment in which options for reducing the environmental impacts of the system under study are identified and estimated. Generally, this step is executed on the basis of results from the previous LCA phases. Now, coming to the advantages of the LCA process. Basically, there are four types of users of LCA. They are the industry and other commercial enterprises, the NGOs, government and regulatory bodies, and at the end, the consumers. Now let's see how LCA helps the industry and other commercial enterprises. LCA helps to understand the various environmental benefits and obligations that exist in the product or service that the industries produce. It also helps them in communication of information when engaging with stakeholders. The stakeholders may include the environmental organizations, the involved communities, interested and affected parties, and government authorities. The primary applications of LCA in the industry are in product improvement, product designing, formulation of company policy, product information, use in negotiations. For product improvement, the manufacturers may conduct LCA studies for creating a base reference from which new products can be developed or the required alterations they need to incorporate in order to reduce the environmental impacts of the product can be analyzed. Also, fresh products are often developed from old designs and ideas, and hence LCA is a beneficial mean of taking old information and relating it with plans, and it also estimates for new product and services. This is known as product designing. Now, coming to formulation of company policies, LCAs can contribute considerably to this aspect. They can help in guidance on the choice of raw materials that could directly affect the company's approach to management of waste materials. In some cases, it could also result in reduction of generation of harmful waste with increased recycling potential. Sometimes government authorities need product information for the purposes of licensing or legal submission. In this case, information obtained from LCAs can be highly useful to the government bodies. Apart from that, information from the LCAs can help to maintain a balance to ensure that the authority requirements are based on certified data and practicality. The outcomes can also be used to upkeep debates relating to the formulation of company policies in terms of best practicable option and best practicable environmental option, etc., while negotiating. As the NGOs are the bridging body between the people and the government authorities, the LCS may make available valuable base data to NGOs on which to act and to motivate for change and improvement. If the NGOs can negotiate with industry to make sure that core LCA data is freely accessible in the perspective of transparency and open corporate governance provisions, then communication on information on goods is less likely to generate complications over this matter. The next category is the government and regulatory bodies. The government and regulatory bodies can take advantage of the LCA process in various terms. The government can utilize the information obtained from the LCA studies in context of the economic and economic activities. The specific areas where the government can use LCAs include eco-labeling, deposit refund schemes, subsidies and taxation, general policy making, etc. We all know about eco-labeling. Eco-labeling is granting recognition to products that achieve a certain minimum standard in environmental friendliness. In context of deposit refund schemes, decision making on whether to introduce deposit refund systems to encourage recycling and reuse of raw materials or not is a very tough task. In that case, detailed LCAs may facilitate an assessment to be made on the viability of deposit refund systems. In case of subsidies and taxation, the LCAs can provide information to inform decisions on this context in terms of shifts in taxation and subsidies, and can also demonstrate how, for example, the purchase and production of cleaner products can be stimulated through subsidies such as low interest loans for manufacturing investments, etc. Apart from that, general policy can be informed by detailed LCAs, particularly on issues such as whether dangerous goods should be transported by rail or road, or how the promotion of differing energy sources can be encouraged depending upon their availability, strategic planning or market flexibilities. The last category of the advantage takers are the consumers. LCA information helps the consumers on the purchasing options based on whether it is environmental friendly or not. By providing buyers with the information to make good choice on price, running cost and pollution potential, national environmental protection goals and policies become easier to implement, and data can be used to demonstrate how changes and improvements can decrease pollution in the short and long term. Other general advantages of LCA include, apart from this, there are certain other advantages of LCA analysis. The cradle-to-grave methodology of LCA outspreads beyond the typical limits of EIA practices. The use of diagrams to illustrate the flows, stages, and processes of LCA is a valuable cognitive tool for capacity building. LCA can also identify and track environmental pollution moving between water, oil, and soil very efficiently. Use of scores with reliable data sets and impact categories helps to make useful comparisons between products and processes in a broader manner as compared to that achieved in environmental impact assessments. Every coin has two sides. So having so many advantages, there are also certain disadvantages in the LCA methodology. Some significant limitations of LCA include the variations in data quality, the life cycle boundaries, scarcity of LCA expertise, cost of LCA studies, access to high quality data, and lack of user-friendly and widely recognized LCA methods. As far as the data quality is concerned, in a manufacturer-sponsored analysis to compare a product or process with its alternatives, data collectors may get current data from the manufacturer, but for the alternative product, they might have to be dependent on secondary data from the literature. Hence, the secondary data from the literature may lead to a lack of credibility in the comparative studies. In most of the studies, they do not consider the working environment. The working ages taken into consideration may not be same all the time, which will lead to a discrepancy for sure in the result. Hence, the limitations in life cycle boundary may be significant in some cases. Apart from that, the lack of environmental awareness, the lack of drivers for chain management and responsibility has been generated as a hurdle to the expansion of LCA. Also, the lack of knowledge for performing and understanding LCA studies in developing countries generally may lead to some limitations in the study result. Communication about LCA procedures and study outputs, particularly to policymakers, is a huge problem. Cost is also an important aspect in LCA studies. The high level of expert understanding required by some complex LCAs, together with the need for procurement of data from commercial databases, put forward high cost. This is also combined sometimes further with the requirements of the ISO necessities for review process. Along with all of this, the data quality and availability also creates a major practical tailback in LCA studies. At the end, in some cases, it might be less user-friendly and there is no widely recognized LCA method. Hence, methodological barriers in LCA, which are involved with the lack of commonly agreed methods, and this appears not to be satisfactorily addressed through the ISO standardization as well. Hence, the lack of user-friendly and widely recognized LCA method pose a limitation to the process. Now we have arrived at the conclusion. We know that everything has its pros as well as cons. We have studied about the advantages as well as the disadvantages of the LCA process. Though it has many disadvantages, the concept and the principle it focuses on is apt for the environmental management. Now the LCA process may be in its infant stage, but further work and study and encouragement to the scientific community and all the stakeholders may lead to a concrete and developed methodological plan in LCA. So with this, we conclude this session. Thank you.